On July 7, 2007, Benedict XVI issued the motu proprio Summorum Pontificum. This Vatican document allowed priests everywhere to celebrate the Old, or the Tridentine Latin Mass, using the 1962 Missal, the last version in force before the Second Vatican Council. Catholics dissatisfied with the new order of Mass promulgated by Paul VI in 1969 were ecstatic. Websites promoting the old Mass proliferated. Members of a younger, more conservative generation of clergy spoke positively about their new experience of offering Mass in the old rite, its dignity, its reverence, its beauty, its deep roots in Catholic tradition. In these comments, one could also sense something else, perhaps unintended. The implication that the Mass of Paul VI, in comparison, did not possess all these wonderful qualities. This leads to the question, why? The answer to that question is the subject of this book, and of the little overview of the book we will be providing with a series of 14 videos. In brief, it will be this. The doctrinal ideas behind the new rite are different from the doctrinal ideas behind the old rite. These new doctrinal ideas affected the externals of the new rite, its prayers, and its ritual gestures. So, if you perceive that in the old rite, the treatment of the Blessed Sacrament is more respectful, the actions of the priest are more dignified, and the atmosphere is more otherworldly when compared with the new rite, the reason is this. The new rite is based on a new theology of the real presence, of the priesthood, and of the general purpose of the Mass. In circles where the old Mass is celebrated under the aegis of the motu proprio, these profound theological differences are usually passed over in silence. Instead, the motives offered for adhering to the old Mass tend to be reduced to beauty, tradition, sentiment, or preference. Work of Human Hands was written precisely in order to put these theological issues front and center in any discussion of the reform of the Mass, past, present, and future. The principal thesis, or underlying contention for Work of Human Hands, may be summed up as follows. The Mass of Paul VI, A, destroys Catholic doctrine in the minds of the faithful, and in particular, Catholic doctrine concerning the Holy Sacrifice of the Mass, the priesthood, and the real presence. And B, permits or prescribes grave irreverence. This proposition will strike many listeners as rather blunt, but it summarizes the principal objections traditionalists have made against the Mass of Paul VI ever since it first appeared in 1969. And it is borne out from a close examination of the new rite. What are called liturgical abuses, departures from official norms for the Mass of Paul VI, won't figure in our discussion here, nor will the various vernacular translations, the good, the bad, and the ugly. Instead, we will look at the official Latin version of the Missal of Paul VI and analyze it in detail by comparing and contrasting it with the traditional Latin Mass. We'll examine the prayers and ceremonies of the Mass of Paul VI in their order of appearance in the rite itself. For explanations, we'll often be able to turn to commentaries written by the liturgists who were directly involved in creating the new Mass. These are often quite revealing. Traditionalist critiques of the new Mass that have appeared over the past 40 years limited their scope to the ordinary of the Mass itself, that is, the parts that remain more or less the same from day to day. Work of Human Hands, however, goes far beyond that and presents a detailed critique of the changes that the Mass of Paul VI introduced into the propers of the Mass. That is, the vast body of prayers and scripture readings, the change from Sunday to Sunday, and feast to feast. Here, too, a real theological shift is evident. Work of human hands also connects many of the liturgical changes to the errors of modernism. The early 20th century heresy that reemerged triumphant during and after Vatican II. In the liturgy, said Archbishop Antonelli, who signed the decree promulgating the Mass of Paul VI, every word and every gesture conveys a theological idea. What theological ideas do the words and gestures of the Mass of Paul VI convey? In the broadcast that follow, we will provide a sampler of some of the answers found in Work of Human Hands, a Theological Critique of the Mass of Paul VI. Our next video will be entitled The Change Agents. Chapter 2, The Liturgical Movement, The Change Agents. Catholic critics of the post-Vatican II Mass reforms generally had the same list of pet peeves about the liturgical changes. A typical roundup of objections against the work of the liturgical reformers might mention replacing Latin with the vernacular, the relentless insistence on vocal participation by the laity, disparaging devotional prayers like the rosary, arbitrary changes in the rubrics, communion under both species. The list might also include some underlying theological errors, promoting the notion that it is the community which celebrates, reducing the role of the priest to someone delegated by the people, or exaggerating the priesthood of the laity. If you were asked to put a date on that list, you'd probably say the late 1960s. The real date, however, is 1942. The list is taken from a 17-point memorandum that the Archbishop of Freiburg, Germany, sent to his fellow bishops. He wrote it to warn them about the proposals for liturgical changes that were then being widely circulated in Germany and in the rest of Europe. This will surprise most listeners. It certainly surprised me when I first came across the list. Like most conservatives during the post-Vatican II era, I thought that the liturgical revolution got underway only after the Council. In fact, it had already been going on in stealth mode for a long, long time. What about the post-Vatican II practice of inviting everyone up to stand around the altar during the canon, for instance? Youth movement and scout masses in France and Germany during the 1920s. Or mass facing the people and exchanging handshakes before communion. Kloster Neuburg, Austria, again, during the 1920s. Chapter 2 of Work of Human Hands traces the origins of these practices and eventually the roots of the Mass of Paul VI to a phenomenon called the liturgical movement. The movement began in the 19th century as a result of the work of the great Benedictine Dom Prosper Geranger, founder of the monastery of Solesmes. The purpose of the movement was to renew fervor for the liturgy among the clergy and the faithful. Its original ideals and initial accomplishments were a great blessing for the church. In the 20th century, unfortunately, the liturgical movement was hijacked by modernists. Among their errors, considering heretical churches part of the church, redefining faith as experience and emotion, and neglecting or even denigrating scholastic or Thomistic philosophy and theology. These charges are not merely my personal conclusions, by the way. They are taken from Archbishop Grober's 1942 memorandum. Pius XII intervened with two encyclicals that attempted to correct these errors. Mystici Corporis, on the Nature of the Church, in 1943, and Mediator Dei, 1947, on the Sacred Liturgy. Both clearly restated Catholic doctrine, condemned various errors, and sought to set the liturgical movement back on the right path. The pontiff reiterated these warnings in a 1956 allocution that he delivered to the leaders of the liturgical movement after the International Congress on Pastoral Liturgy. By then, unfortunately, many influential bishops had already embraced the movement's theories and were patiently working to implement its goals. Most would become part of the progressive faction a few years later at Vatican II. Among them was a certain Monsignor Giovanni Battista Montini, who had been celebrating masses for small gatherings of university students, with, as he said, the group praying around the altar. Work of Human Hands also discusses two very influential writers from the pre-Vatican II liturgical movement, whose theories on liturgical reform and the nature of the Mass will resurface in the Mass of Paul VI. The first figure is the Austrian Jesuit Josef Jungmann. One of his key ideas was the corruption theory, which held that the Mass, as it stood, represented a departure from primitive liturgical ideals. After the Peace of Constantine, it seems, everything in the liturgy was mostly all downhill. Another of Jungmann's ideas was pastoral liturgy. By this he meant refashioning the Mass to meet the perceived needs of contemporary man. The second figure is the French oratorian Louis Bouilhet. His 1954 work Liturgical Piety lays out two concepts that will become the theological foundation for the Mass of Paul VI. One was assembly theology. This Bouilhet used to bypass the Catholic doctrine that the essence of the Mass consists in the sacrifice. Another was Bouilhet's invention of other so-called real presences, which Bouilhet inflated in order to attack and undermine the Catholic dogma on the real presence. For an analysis of the writings of Jungmann and Bouilhet, as well as a history of the liturgical movement, see The Change Agents, Chapter 2 of Work of Human Hands, A Theological Critique of the Mass of Paul VI. Our next chapter, The Creation of the New Mass.
Conspiracy theory. Liberals, whether religious or political, routinely intone the phrase whenever a conservative suggests that the bad guys just might be working together behind the scenes. But consider the following. It's a wish list from a secret meeting of would-be liturgical reformers and gives their proposals for changes in the Mass. Having the priest start the Mass at the bench, using the vernacular, introducing more scripture, reducing genuflections, changing the offertory prayers, de-emphasizing the consecration, shortening the canon. You might say, that hardly sounds conspiratorial. These changes were talked about openly in the 1960s, and they all became part of the new Mass. Of course, but the secret meeting wasn't held in the 1960s. It was held at Bounce Abbey in Germany in 1948. And the man making the proposals was Josef Jungmann. These were all part of what he called his Traum im Herzen, his heart's dream for the reform of the Mass. Surprisingly, the process that would turn these dreams into the reality of the Mass of Paul VI began at once. Chapter 3 of Work of Human Hands tells the story of that process, how it unfolded step by step, reform by reform, beginning in 1948 and finally arriving at its goal in April 1969, when Paul VI promulgated his new Mass. In 1948, a Vatican commission was appointed to study the question of liturgical reform. The secretary of the commission was Annibale Bonini, a secret supporter of the liturgical movement's left wing. Under Bonini, with Jungmann as a consultant, the commission would introduce a series of gradual liturgical changes throughout the 1950s. A new Easter Vigil rite in 1951, a simplification of the rubrics in 1955, completely revised rites for Holy Week in 1955, permission for lay commentators and lectors in 1958. As these changes were being introduced in the 1950s, Bonini called them a bridge to the future, part of building a new city in which the man of our age can live and feel at ease. Bonini urged those eager for a fuller renewal to keep their eyes open, because liturgical reform would require the enlightened collaboration of all the active forces. In 1960, after John XXIII announced he was convoking the Second Vatican Council, the previous changes and simplifications were consolidated into a temporary code.
Meanwhile, Bonini, aided by Jungmann, was assigned to write Vatican II's Constitution on the Sacred Liturgy. The Constitution contains much orthodox terminology and recommends some praiseworthy things, but its creators deliberately salted it with ambiguous or equivocal statements that could later be used to implement radical changes.
Retain tradition, yes, but allow legitimate progress too. Preserve Latin, but give the vernacular a place. Rites should be noble, but also simple. Keep sacred images, but don't let them cause confusion.
To bypass the conservatives in the Roman Curia, Paul VI created a new agency to implement the liturgical changes, Concilium, and put Bonini in charge. Bonini set up a special Concilium subcommittee, Study Group 10, to formulate a new order of Mass.
Its head was Monsignor Johannes Wagner, who had taken the notes at the secret meetings in Germany in 1948. Among its 11 members was Louis Bouillet, the proponent of the new theology of the Mass as assembly rather than as a sacrifice.
And of course, Josef Jungmann, whose 1948 Traum in Herzen, his heart's dream, for a stripped-down Mass, he could now make a reality. To find out how the liturgical revolutionaries slowly made the traditional Mass disappear, step by step, over 20 years, see The Creation of the New Mass, Chapter 3 of Work of Human Hands, A Theological Critique of the Mass of Paul VI.
Chapter 4, Latin to the Vernacular, Lost in Translation.
By the time the new Mass appeared in 1969, Latin had disappeared from the Mass just about everywhere in the world. From the moment this transformation began in 1964, conservatives and progressives argued over what Vatican II really meant when it dealt with the issues of Latin and the vernacular. But the passages in Vatican II's Constitution on the Sacred Liturgy referring to the preservation of Latin and the introduction of the vernacular are ambiguously worded and susceptible to contradictory interpretations.
So on one hand, according to the Constitution, yes, Latin is to be preserved. But on the other hand, also according to the Constitution, Latin is not to be preserved, if giving the mother tongue a suitable place in some parts of the Mass may be of great advantage to the people. Moreover, especially where an even more radical adaptation of the liturgy is needed, a more extended use of the vernacular may appear desirable.
The practical effect of this gobbledygook would hinge on who would interpret or define the terms advantage to the people, suitable place, and extended use.
And after Vatican II, of course, this was Father Bonini, who wrote the Constitution, Concilium, which had the authority to interpret the Constitution, Paul VI, who had long advocated vernacular and who backed up Concilium's decisions, and the National Bishops' Conferences, who under the provisions of the Constitution had the right to petition for the vernacular.
Chapter 4 of Work of Human Hands tells this story. It also offers a resume of the question of Latin versus the vernacular for the celebration of Mass. Absolute intelligibility was not a requirement for liturgical language in the time of our Lord or in the early church. For 1600 years, the church carefully preserved the special status of Latin as the language for the Mass of the Roman Rite. Apart from that, the church encouraged Eastern Rites to retain their proper languages. She occasionally even permitted the Mass of the Roman Rite to be celebrated in a modern language. But these were not real precedents for the post-Vatican II process of vernacularizing the Mass. The languages used in the various Eastern Rites were not true vernaculars in every case. Moreover, the Holy See required that the translations of the Roman Rite Mass be slavishly faithful to the Latin original. Hardly the case with the post-Vatican II translations.
Why retain Latin as a liturgical language? Catholic scholars gave four reasons: sacredness, unity, unchangeableness, and tradition. All of these reflect doctrinal truths about the Mass or the Catholic faith. Advocating the abandonment of Latin for the vernacular, on the other hand, is historically linked with the corruption of doctrinal truth. The vernacular was used as a means to spread heresy, to falsify doctrine through mistranslations, and to deny the objective value of the holy sacrifice of the Mass.
In 2011, 40 years after the Mass of Paul VI was promulgated, a more accurate official English translation of the Latin original finally appeared. Conservative Catholics had long criticized the inaccuracy of the English translations approved in the early 1970s.
To take one example, the word gratia, grace, appeared 11 times in the orations for ordinary time in the Latin original of the Missal of Paul VI. It didn't appear in the official English translations of these prayers even once. Grace disappeared without a trace. We conservatives then claimed that this was the mischief of progressives in the National Bishops' Conferences.
In fact, it was the result of the official policy of the Holy See. Three documents issued between 1964 and 1967 by Concilium, the Vatican office entrusted with implementing the liturgical reform, progressively allowed more freedom to adapt translations.
The final blow to any pretense at accuracy in translations came with the Vatican instruction Comme le prévoit, January 25, 1969, which laid down the principles that produced the distortions, omissions, and outright errors in modern liturgical translations.
Who ultimately was responsible for approving the document that caused this mess? Was it, as we conservatives in the 1970s used to claim, a wicked band of modernist conspirators who surrounded our beloved Holy Father? Or does the blame really rest with someone a bit higher up? To find out the answer, read Lost in Translation, Chapter 4 of Work of Human Hands, A Theological Critique of the Mass of Paul VI. Chapter 5. The 1969 General Instruction, The Mass as Assembly. In our first broadcast, we mentioned the positive qualities so many Catholics now see in the traditional Latin Mass: its dignity, its reverence, its roots in tradition. We also said that these qualities indicated an underlying doctrinal difference between the old Mass and the Mass of Paul VI. One that affected the prayers and the ritual gestures of the Mass of Paul VI. Ample evidence for this underlying difference is found in the subject for this broadcast, the 1969 General Instruction on the Roman Missal. The 1969 General Instruction was a 341-paragraph Latin document bound in the front of the first printed edition of the New Order of Mass of Paul VI. It contained all the ritual directions for celebrating the new form of Mass, but the document was intended to be more than that. The creators of the new Mass envisioned the instruction as a theological exposition or a doctrinal presentation to help people understand the nature
and significance of the elements of the new rite. As such, the 1969 General Instruction should be treated as the theological blueprint for the Mass of Paul VI. What does this blueprint tell us about the theology behind the new rite? Is it the same as the old theology of the Mass? We begin with a definition. Traditional Catholic theology defines the essence of the Mass as a sacrifice. Article 7 of the 1969 General Instruction, however, defines the Mass as an assembly. Here is the definition. The Lord's Supper, or Mass, is the sacred assembly or congregation of the people of God gathering together with a priest presiding in order to celebrate the memorial of the Lord. For this reason, Christ's promise applies supremely to such a local gathering of the Church. Where two or three come together in my name, there am I in their midst. What are some of the problems with this? Lord's Supper is a term favored by Protestants, who do not use the word Mass. Assembly was substituted for sacrifice. People of God is a Vatican II term that includes non-Catholics. The priest merely presides, and the assembly celebrates. The equivocal term memorial is used. It is understood in a heretical sense by Protestants and in an orthodox sense by Catholics. Instead of the presence of Christ being substantial through the miracle of transubstantiation, it is depicted as just somehow spiritual in the assembly. This new definition originates in the assembly theology of the Mass, proposed by Louis Bouillet in his 1954 work, Liturgical Piety. We've already mentioned Bouillet and his ideas in broadcast two. Where did Bouillet get this particular idea? In Liturgical Piety, he says he bases it on the Eucharistic teaching of Ingvar Brilioth, a 1930s Swedish Lutheran and ecumenist. Bouillet's book is filled with praise for the theories Brilioth laid out in his own book, Eucharistic Faith and Practice, Evangelical and Catholic. So, it's no surprise to hear an ecumenist like Father J.M. Tiard praise the new definition of the Mass found in the 1969 General Instruction. He says that terms in the definition like Lord's Supper, people of God, and memorial were adopted in an explicitly ecumenical spirit and were the fruits of doctrinal convergence with non-Catholics. Nor is it surprising to read the critical comment that a conservative liturgist, Monsignor Klaus Gamber, made about the same passage. Almost any believing Protestant of whatever denomination would be able to assent to such a definition. Other ideas from the Bouillet-Brilioth ecumenical theology pop up throughout the 1969 General Instruction. For instance, the document speaks of various presences of Christ at Mass, in the assembled people, in the priest who presides, and in Scripture. All these presences now are supposedly real. Transubstantiation, however, the real presence of Christ at Mass, was not mentioned. The term is detested by modernists because it reflects traditional Thomistic theology, and by Protestants as repugnant to the plain words of Scripture. Chapter 5 of Work of Human Hands examines these and other elements of the assembly theology of the Mass presented in the 1969 General Instruction. In addition to these doctrinal questions, Chapter 5 also explains how the General Instruction deregulated large portions of the Mass. In the decree promulgating his new Mass, Paul VI says it provides for legitimate variations and adaptations. In practice, this meant that the official legislation for the new rite allowed priests or parish liturgy committees to select one text or rite from a number of options, to omit or adapt certain texts or rites, and in many cases to introduce or invent texts as they saw fit. This has always been a sore point for conservatives, and explains why a Catholic never knows what to expect when he walks into an unfamiliar church for Mass. Will the style be American suburban casual? High-toned aestheticism downtown with chunks of Latin? Newman Center feel-good? The rite of EWTN? Or even Mexican mariachi? You never know what you'll run into. Even worse, deregulation leaves large chunks of the doctrinal content of the Mass up to individual priests and parish liturgy planners. In many cases, it leaves them free to introduce into liturgical prayer virtually any religious idea they want. They determine the lex orandi for each Sunday, your law of praying. So they also determine your lex credendi, your law of believing. I'm sure they're all really very nice folks, but it's crazy that the official norms governing the Mass of Paul VI allow them to do this. Public prayer affects common beliefs. If error creeps into public prayer, it will poison common beliefs. Conceived in ecumenical assembly theology and deregulated in its form of celebration, no wonder the old Mass and the new Mass seem to be in two different theological universes. But we've only touched upon a few points here. To find out the rest about the 1969 General Instruction, its new theology of the Mass and its deregulation of the liturgy, read The Mass as Assembly, Chapter 5 of Work of Human Hands, A Theological Critique of the Mass of Paul VI. Chapter 6, The 1970 General Instruction, The Cleverness of the Revisers. Paul VI promulgated his new Mass on April 3, 1969. By this time, conservative Catholics, they would later be called traditionalists, had endured 5 years of liturgical changes after Vatican II. To them, each stage seemed to bring the Mass closer to Protestantism and closer to the teaching of the modernist theologians. In August 1966, six Protestant clergymen, some of whom are shown here greeting Paul VI, were invited to serve as observers as the Vatican agency responsible for liturgical change, Concilium, went about its work of overhauling the Catholic liturgy. When the new order of Mass and the General Instruction finally appeared in 1969, Protestantism and the new theology seemed to have triumphed. But what to do? In the conservative camp were two members of Roman high society, Emilia Pediconi and Vittoria Guerini. The latter was a poet, a writer, and a translator who wrote under the pseudonym of Cristina Campo. Both women were friends of Alfredo Cardinal Ottaviani, who had by then retired from his post as prefect of the Holy Office, and both women had wide connections in ecclesiastical circles. These determined women used their contacts to bring together a small group of conservative theologians, liturgists, and pastors, who decided to prepare a critical study of the new order of Mass. Cardinal Ottaviani agreed to revise the study and to present it to Paul VI. The group met a number of times in April and May 1969. The task of preparing a suitable text fell to a Dominican theologian and philosopher, Father M. L. Gerard de Laurier, then a professor at the Pontifical Lateran University in Rome. The result was a short critical study of the new order of Mass, Breve Esame Critico del Novus Ordo Missae, now known in English-speaking countries as the Ottaviani Intervention. Cardinal Ottaviani composed a covering letter to Paul VI, which supported the study's conclusions. The organizers, among them Archbishop Marcel Lefebvre, lined up a large number of high-ranking ecclesiastics, including a dozen cardinals, to sign the letter along with Cardinal Ottaviani.
Taviani spent several days examining the critical study and signed it on September 13, 1969. Unfortunately, the secrecy of the project was compromised the next day. This scared off the rest of the signers, except for Antonio Cardinal Bacci, a prelate who did not scare easily. He had earlier written a laudatory preface to a book that condemned the liturgical reform and called the cardinal who headed it Luther resurrected. Bacci signed on September 28th. The following day, the letter and the critical study were presented to Paul VI. The intervention offered a scathing theological critique of both the 1969 general instruction and the new rite of Mass itself. It condemned the new definition of the Mass as assembly, de-emphasis on the Mass as a sacrifice of propitiation, the reduction of the priest's role, implicit denials of the real presence and transubstantiation, and countless other details in the instruction and in the rite itself. A major controversy ensued. At first, the reformers denied that the general instruction was a theological or a doctrinal statement. This was a lie. As I demonstrate in Chapter 6 of Work of Human Hands, before the controversy, the reformers themselves had repeatedly said the instruction would explain the theological and doctrinal principles behind the new Mass. In two audiences in November 1969, Paul VI publicly defended the orthodoxy of the new Mass. In a further attempt to quell doctrinal objections to the new Mass, the Vatican issued a new 15-paragraph foreword or premium to the Missal, aimed at defending the orthodoxy of the new rite. The Vatican also issued a revised version of the 1969 general instruction. The procedure was to insert a tridentine term alongside many of the terms in the general instruction that the intervention had condemned as Protestant or modernist. You can see this method at work in the revised version of Article 7, the definition of the Mass. The tridentine terms that were inserted are highlighted in red rectangles and placed alongside the Protestant or modernist terms, which are highlighted with blue circles. The terms are equated, leaving the impression that one is free to understand the Mass either way, as a sacrifice or as an assembly supper. The end result was enough to fool many conservatives, but ambiguous enough to accommodate ecumenism and modernist theology. One member of Concilium, however, gave the game away. Father Emil Lengeling, a German theologian, liturgist, and ecumenist, cynically boasted that the 1970 instruction still kept us out of the dead end of the post-Tridentine theories of sacrifice, thanks to what he called the cleverness of the revisers. And he had a lot to crow about. For despite the cosmetic changes in the instruction, the prayers and rites of the 1970 Order of Mass are identical to those of the 1969 Novus Ordo Missae. Thus, the episode of the 1970 General Instruction was nothing more than a little game played on paper. It was as if an architect had designed a building that promptly began to collapse, and he solved the problem by scribbling a few changes on his original blueprints and then putting them back into a drawer. What the architect drew on his defective blueprints does not change the structure that he actually built, and it sure won't keep the bricks from falling on someone's head. The only real solution is to dynamite the collapsing building and to haul away the rubble. The key to understanding the theology behind the Mass of Paul VI, now used in our cathedrals and parish churches, therefore, lies not in the pseudo-Tridentine foreword and general instruction of 1970. Rather, we find it in the general instruction of 1969, a document based on the modernist assembly theology of Louis Bouillet, itself founded on the writings of the Lutheran ecumenist Inga Brilliot. If your Mass is the new Mass, these men provided the theology behind it. To find out more about the Ottaviani intervention and the 1970 general instruction, read The Cleverness of the Revisers, Chapter 6 of Work of Human Hands, A Theological Critique of the Mass of Paul VI. Chapter 7, Art, Architecture, Furnishings, Ready for Assembly. As a seminarian in the early 1970s, I went to the dedication for a brand new church at a Benedictine abbey in the American Middle West. From the outside, it looked like an oddly shaped bunker. The inside featured clear glass windows, blonde wood beams, bare concrete walls, a square table altar, and two images. The misshapen ping pong paddle is the abbot's crozier. In the sacristy after the ceremony, the abbot, who had a reputation as a bit of a wit, thanked the archbishop and clergy who had participated, adding at the end of his remarks, "And if it fails as a church, it'll make a really great restaurant." We have all been in churches like this. Is it a church, or is it really a food court? I don't know about you, but the stained glass window looks an awful lot like Starbucks to me. Why do so many churches built for the Mass of Paul VI look so unchurchy? Why does the priest face the people now for Mass? Why did the tabernacle disappear? Why are there so few statues and images? The answer isn't fads or bad taste. It's bad theology, specifically the modernist theology of the Mass as assembly. As we saw on broadcast 5, assembly theology was the underlying basis for the creation of the new Mass. Naturally, understanding the Mass primarily as an assembly supper rather than as a sacrifice offered to God will have a profound influence on the externals of the rite. Chapter 7 of Work of Human Hands examines how assembly theology affected the new legislation governing the externals of the Mass of Paul VI, church architecture, the altar, the tabernacle, and the rest. The 1969 General Instruction and the post-Vatican II rite for the dedication of a church laid down the guiding principle. They prescribed that the plan of a church should convey the image of the gathered assembly. One of Bonini's collaborators, Father Alessandro Pistoia, wrote an extensive commentary on this shift of emphasis. The exaltation of the majesty of God, the glorification of the saints, and private devotion, he said, are no longer important considerations in the design of churches. The objective of the new liturgical environment, rather, is to promote a celebration in which the assembly actively participates. The basis for this, he said, is the whole rediscovered biblical liturgical theology of assembly. One of the most striking features of the post-Vatican II liturgical changes, and one intimately linked to assembly theology, was Mass celebrated facing the people, which was adopted everywhere after Vatican II. Father José María Martín Patino, who is a member of Concilium Study Group 10, was directly involved in creating the new order of Mass, pointed out this connection. The modern notion of Mass facing the people, he said, is based on an anthropocentric or man-centered theology, rather than as before on a theocentric or God-centered theology. In recent years, some have begun to advocate celebrating the Mass of Paul VI in the old direction, facing east, or ad orientem, as they say. For the liturgy of the Word, the priest faces the people. For the liturgy of the Eucharist, he faces the altar with his back to the people, an arrangement that looks a little like the old Mass. The most prominent apologist for this, if not the man who inspired the movement in the first place, was Joseph Cardinal Ratzinger, first in a 1981 article, and then in a book published in 2000. "Christian liturgy," said Ratzinger, "must be cosmic liturgy. Facing East makes this cosmic dimension of the Eucharist present through liturgical gesture." Facing the altar, he continued, was in reality expressing a view of the Eucharistic celebration in the context of cosmos and parousia. Cosmos, cosmic. Sounds mystical and devotional, doesn't it? Since Ratzinger was permanently labeled the great watchdog of orthodoxy, one might think that such language was rooted in good old-fashioned traditional Catholic theology. In fact, however, Ratzinger lifted his cosmic terminology directly from two modernists. The first was Hans Urs von Balthasar, specifically his books Cosmic Liturgy and The Glory of the Lord. Due to the mystical tone, some would say the pseudo-mystical tone, of his writings, Balthasar has become popular among conservatives who consider him quite traditional. In reality, though, Balthasar detested traditional Thomistic theology, which he said he felt like tearing down with Samson's own strength. Ratzinger's second source for cosmic was the works of Pierre Teilhard de Chardin, a Jesuit evolutionist silenced by the Holy Office in 1925 and thereafter forbidden to write. Teilhard's ideas on the cosmic Christ and the omega point of cosmic evolution enjoyed a great vogue for a while after Vatican II, and amounted to not so thinly veiled pantheism. It will come as a surprise to many to hear that Ratzinger has long been a promoter of this heretic. Indeed, as Benedict XVI, he has even worked Teilhard and Teilhardian terminology into his public discourses, as during this Vesper homily in Aosta, where he spoke of Teilhard's great vision, where, quote, "at the end of time, we will have a true cosmic liturgy, where the cosmos becomes a living host." The movement to offer the Mass of Paul VI facing East, or ad orientem as they say, will of course appeal to many Catholics of a traditional bent. Hey, it sure looks like the old rite. But rather than from Trent and Thomism, it springs from the toxic Teilhard, adrift in his own theological cosmos. Before Vatican II, the Blessed Sacrament was reserved in a tabernacle on the high altar of nearly every Catholic church in the world. All that has changed. These days you never know where you'll find the tabernacle. The possibilities are endless. How did this come about? Vatican II prescribed a revision for church laws dealing with sacred art and furnishings, including the placement of the tabernacle. So, a series of post-Vatican II laws first forbade the celebration of Mass on an altar with a tabernacle, then removed the tabernacle from a prominent place in the sanctuary, and finally consigned it to a separate chapel. The Benedictine Abbey restaurant church we mentioned put the tabernacle in this little sacrament cave. The new legislation explained that the prohibition against celebrating Mass on an altar where the Blessed Sacrament was reserved was based, quote, on grounds of sign value, unquote, because Christ is present in the assembly, in scripture, in the homily, in the minister, and only then under the Eucharistic elements. Modernist assembly theology, in other words, dictates the exile of the tabernacle. The same assembly theology behind the definition of the Mass in Article 7 of the 1969 General Instruction. Another notable feature of the reform was the hostility towards religious statues and images. Old churches were stripped of them, and new churches were built without them. Vatican II's Constitution on the Sacred Liturgy stated first that the practice of placing sacred images in churches for veneration by the faithful is to be maintained. But it added a second statement, which effectively negated the first. Nevertheless, there is to be restraint regarding their number and prominence, so that they do not create confusion among the Christian people or foster religious practices of doubtful orthodoxy. This passage contains five fuzzy or equivocal terms: restraint, number, prominence, confusion, and practices of doubtful orthodoxy. These terms raise more questions than they answer, and will be used to strip Catholic churches everywhere of statues and images. On the question of images, the 1969 General Instruction adds, "There is a need both to limit their number and to situate them in such a way that they do not distract the people's attention from the celebration." Bottom line, keep your eyes on that Cantor Lady, or get real used to looking at that bare wall. Talk about options. To find out more about the reasons behind the post-Vatican II changes in church art, architecture, and furnishings, read Ready for Assembly, Chapter 7 of Work of Human Hands, A Theological Critique of the Mass of Paul VI. Chapter 8, Introductory Rites, Meeting and Greeting. When I began researching this book in the 1980s, I decided to observe how Sunday Masses were celebrated at different churches in Rochester, New York. One Mass was particularly memorable. After the entrance song, which was accompanied by guitars and percussion, the priest greeted the congregation with a cheery good morning, to which they all responded, "Good morning, Father Chuck." Father Chuck took the wireless microphone and began wandering up and down the aisle, talking, joking, and inviting comments from members of the gathered assembly. The high point, or perhaps the low point, came when Father Chuck spotted me in the back and had the assembly give me a round of applause. If we were to visit Father Chuck's church these days, we can pretty much imagine that he'd be beginning his Mass just about the same way he did 30 years ago. But we might also encounter his young assistant, Father Retro, clad in a high-collared cassock from Gamarelli, the papal tailors. Father Retro, part of the JP2 generation of priests, might confide he doesn't care for Father Chuck's loosey-goosey, warm and fuzzy liturgical style. "When I offer Mass," he might tell you, "it's just the way Paul VI wanted it, strictly by the book. Do the red, say the black, the rite of EWTN. What's more, Father Retro might even tell you that he's just about to celebrate the old Latin Mass, the extraordinary form, he calls it, in a side chapel. This would be a great opportunity to compare the old rite and the new rite. If we were to watch both simultaneously, Father Retro's Latin Mass in the side chapel and Father Chuck's version of the Mass of Paul VI at the main altar, what differences would we notice? The first would be the opposite directions in which the priests conduct the respective rites. In the old rite, the priest faces the altar, symbolically towards God. In the new rite, he faces the people, symbolically towards man, a change from what we saw Father Patino call a theocentric or God-centered orientation to an anthropocentric or man-centered orientation. Not only is the physical direction of the rites different, but their structure and purpose as well. The prayers and rites that begin the traditional Mass are directed towards priestly purification, the prayers at the foot of the altar, for instance, and the praise or supplication of God, the introit, the Kyrie, the Gloria, and the Collect. In the Mass of Paul VI, other purposes have been substituted. The General Instruction says the purpose of the introductory rites is to ensure that the assembled faithful establish communion and dispose themselves for what follows. Note the typical modernist expression, establish communion. Here again, we see modernist assembly theology at work through the inflation of language. Another type of communion is created in order to devalue the communion of the Mass. Other liturgists picked up on these ideas and relentlessly promoted them. And Father Patino, a member of Concilium Study Group 10 who worked directly on creating the new order of Mass, said the purpose of the introductory rites is to stir up a sense of community, to arouse enthusiasm, to foster unanimity, to enliven faith in the Lord's presence among the assembly.
These are goals for pep rallies or group therapy, not the opening rites of the Mass. But with the introductory rites of the Mass of Paul VI, we have stumbled into another religious universe, and it's a long way from the foot of the altar.
The first element in the introductory rites is the entrance song. This is supposed to intensify the unity of the gathered people. More assembly theology, of course. The entrance song replaced what in the old Mass is called the introit. For the introit, you were required to use the text given in the Missal. The entrance song, on the other hand, is a typical example of liturgical deregulation. The general instruction offers various options. In practice, when the new Mass is celebrated, the liturgy planner decides what the text for the entrance song will say, what musical style will be used, and what instruments will accompany the song. What will intensify the unity of this particular assembly? So it can be a schola singing a Latin chant, a more contemporary sound, a young lady leading on eagle's wings, something from the monastic tradition, a hymn accompanied by a mighty organ, or even a polka entrance song, Roll Out the Barrel.
In the deregulated liturgy of Paul VI, Father Retro can choose old-fashioned Catholic options, and Father Chuck can rock or even polka on to his warm and fuzzy heart's content. When I was a seminarian after Vatican II and planning liturgies as a church musician, I was certainly in the Father Retro camp. As far as I was concerned, the more traditional options you could heap onto a celebration of the new Mass, the better. But I eventually realized that the new norms governing how the Mass of Paul VI can be celebrated allow a broad spectrum of options for countless features of the rite.
It all fits in on what we could call the Chuck Retro liturgical scale. What you choose is entirely permitted under the new rules, and it's mostly just a matter of taste. Where does your parish fit in?
Next, we turn to the greeting. The old Mass, one liturgist complained, began almost brutally. The Mass began from cold. So, the new Mass would have a greeting to make it warmer and more people-friendly.
For a historical precedent, liturgists cited a short remark by St. Augustine about how he began Mass. Salutavi populum, I greeted the people. Perhaps they imagine the saint as a 4th century North African Father Chuck.
By means of the greeting, says the general instruction, the priest signifies the presence of the Lord to the assembled community. So, a whole new theology grew up around the greeting.
Bognini's assistant, Father Carlo Braga, said the greeting begins dialogue between the priest and the people, fosters their communion, signals the nature of the gathering, in whose midst is present Christ himself. the presence of Christ among those gathered in his name is declared.
And here we see once again, chugging along at full steam, modernist assembly theology, which corrupts theological concepts by corrupting language. According to Braga, dialogue, a merely natural act, brings about communion, a word normally applied only to the Holy Eucharist. This communion indicates the nature of the gathering, in whose midst Christ himself is present.
So, with the greeting, we are back to the Bouillet-Brilliot modernist ecumenical theology of other real presences. These were invented to devalue the real presence. Other liturgists followed the lead given by the men who created the new Mass. The purpose of the greeting, said Father Johannes Emminghaus, is to help form a human community, oriented toward the presence of the Lord in his assembled community. Even the way the priest extends his hands to greet the congregation is important. It should look like an invitation or an embrace, not be excessively restrained and ritualistic, but be marked by ease and affability. After the greeting, the general instruction says that the priest, deacon, or a lay minister may introduce the faithful to the Mass of the day with a few words. Vatican II itself specifically prescribed that the Reformed liturgy allow for such comments. Father Peter Coughlin, another one of Bognini's assistants in Concilium, called this an opportunity which allows the celebrant to fill out the greeting in a more spontaneous and informal way. Other liturgists followed suit. You can go beyond the official greeting to a more personal one. The exhortation, apart from its psychological appropriateness, can also be seen as a communication of the Spirit to the community. It can establish good rapport between the priest and people, by a strong horizontal awareness of the assembled people.
What we have said so far in this broadcast should be enough to indicate the profound theological shift behind the changes in the introductory rites. Priestly purification and protestations of unworthiness have given way to stirring up a sense of community, dialogue, affability, forming a human community, building rapport, and acknowledging Christ's presence in the people.
So while a young conservative like Father Retro may think that the Mass of Paul VI calls for a 1940s liturgical style as buttoned up as his Gamarelli cassock, it's actually the old loosey-goosey Father Chucks who had the theology of the new rite figured out all along. It's all about the assembly. The men who created the new Mass told us so.
Which is why all Father Chucks and all Father Retros should read Meeting and Greeting, Chapter 8 of Work of Human Hands, a theological critique of the Mass of Paul VI. Our next chapter, the Revised Orations, New Values, New Perspectives. But please, Father Chuck, hold the applause.
Chapter 9, The Revised Orations, New Values, New Perspectives.
For many years, one aspect of the liturgical reform that went mostly unnoticed among traditionalists was the changes in the variable prayers of the Mass called the orations. These are the short prayers prescribed for each Sunday or feast day Mass.
In both the Old and the New Rite, an oration is recited immediately after the Kyrie. The contents of these prayers reflects the liturgical season or the feast commemorated on the liturgical calendar. There are always at least three orations for every Mass, and they form the bulk of the contents of both the traditional Missal and the Missal of Paul VI. Without reference to specialized works, it is difficult, even for a liturgy geek, to spot the differences between individual texts, because the number of orations in both missals is so large, and because they follow two entirely different liturgical calendars.
I myself discovered this only by accident, when I was searching for a text in the traditional Missal and grabbed the Latin version of the Missal of Paul VI by mistake. In Chapter 9 of Work of Human Hands, we compare the orations in the Old Roman Missal with their counterparts in the Missal of Paul VI. A number of very striking facts emerge.
The traditional Missal contains 1,182 orations. About 760 of those were dropped entirely when the Missal of Paul VI was created. 422 of the old orations remained, only 36%. The revisers altered over half of them before introducing them into the new Missal. Thus, only 17% of the old orations survived untouched in the Missal of Paul VI.
If you want to engage in what is now popularly called a hermeneutic of discontinuity and rupture between the pre- and post-Vatican II liturgy, all you need to base it on is these statistics for the orations.
But even more to our point in Work of Human Hands, this discontinuity and rupture affected the doctrinal content of the orations.
Father Carlo Braga, who worked on this aspect of the reform, said the revisions affected the doctrinal reality, incorporating new views of human values, ecumenical requirements, new positions of the Church, and a new foundation of Eucharistic theology. Changing the texts was necessary, he said, in order to bring to light new values and new perspectives.
So, what doctrinal realities were revised in the new orations? To answer this question, Chapter 9 of Work of Human Hands compares the old orations with those in the Missal of Paul VI, and reveals that the changes in the texts affected six areas of doctrine in particular.
The first category of doctrinal reality to be updated in the orations was a broad one, what Concilium's revisers termed negative theology, an elusive concept they described rather than defined.
Concilium's Father Matthias Auger, for instance, said the old Advent orations were impoverished, too negative, too moralizing. So too the Lenten orations, which were of little relevance to the mentality of modern man. Some of these collects, in fact, spoke of, among other things, the punishments, anger, or divine wrath for our sins, of a Christian assembly oppressed with guilt, continually afflicted due to its disorders, threatened with condemnation to eternal punishment.
To be sure, these are theological dinosaurs in modern man's world of evolving morality.
As an aside, I have to note here that Father Auger himself did not care much for Work of Human Hands. He said the title of the book itself is an open polemic against the Pauline reform, as if it were nothing more than the product of human scheming.
Talk about negative. Be that as it may, a comparison of the old orations with the revised orations in the Missal of Paul VI reveals that Father Auger and company systematically eliminated from the orations various doctrinal concepts at variance with modernist theology. Here are some examples.
The depravity of sin. Sin as gravely offending the divine majesty, perdition, divine wrath, the burden of evil, chastisements in this life for sin, our weak will, concupiscence, our pride, our unworthiness, compunction, the loss of heaven, eternal punishment, the pains of hell, the fire of hell, fasting, mortification, and death as the penalty for our guilt.
In light of these suppressions overall, it thus becomes quite easy to understand what the men who created the new Missal meant by negative theology.
Any language that emphasizes the wickedness of sin as the greatest evil and its dire consequences for us in this world and in the next. Contemporary man does not want to hear about such things, and the missal of Paul VI accommodates him. Second, the revisers removed from the orations the standard language in many orations to the saints that expressed the eternal conflict between the Christian and the spirit of the world. Thus, they eliminated notions such as
detachment, overcoming the enticements of this life, perishable delights, contempt of all earthly things, leave all things in this world, and above all, to despise the things of this world, a phrase that appears time and again throughout the old orations, even in the one to St. Francis of Assisi, the saint that the world itself regards as singularly unthreatening to its values.
Third, naturally, the revisers excised from the prayers for the dead all the elements of negative theology mentioned above.
They also routinely cut out the Latin word for soul, anima, which appeared in the old orations for the dead. In selecting the orations for the dead in the new missal, the revisers dropped 11 of the traditional orations which employed the word soul. And of the 25 traditional orations they retained, they purged the word soul from 23 of them. Prayers, therefore, are no longer offered for the soul of John Smith, but simply for John Smith. While the traditional missal uses the word soul in all 9 orations on All Souls Day, the new missal does not use it even once.
Perhaps the Reformers should have renamed November 2nd No Souls Day. Fourth, many orations were changed to accommodate Vatican II's ecumenism because they contained language that Concilium's Father Carlo Braga called no longer in harmony with the new positions of the Church. Thus, the revisers eliminated from the orations notions such as
subjection to the rule of Christ the King, the Church militant, overcoming heresy, and phrases which reflected the rights and governing power of the Roman pontiff. Even the most ancient prayers in the Missal that contained this language, the solemn orations on Good Friday, were not spared. Bonini said that they had to be changed because they sounded rather bad in the ecumenical climate of Vatican II, and because no one should find a motive for spiritual discomfort in the prayer of the Church.
No one, perhaps, but those who still believe in praying that the world be converted to the truth of the Catholic faith.
Fifth, on at least 200 occasions throughout the liturgical year, the orations in the traditional missal invoke the merits of the saints. The revisers virtually eliminated this notion from the new missal, where it appears in just 13 prayers, of which only 3 are obligatory. Ecumenism, no doubt, was one of the motives for this change. While the Church teaches that we can merit for ourselves and others, classical Protestantism held that human nature was so corrupt that it could not merit anything. Abolish the word in the orations for the saints, and another ecumenical roadblock disappears.
Sixth, the revisers removed from the orations allusions to the miracles of the saints to make the orations, they said, better suited to the mentality of contemporary man.
Even our Lord's own miracles were not exempt from this treatment. Thus, the revisers removed from the orations allusions to our Lord's transfiguration and to his raising of Lazarus from the dead. This was a surrender to the modernist heresy which treats miracles as myths and fables. Negative theology, hell, the false glory of the world, the souls of the departed, the evils of heresy, the one true church, the powers of the Roman pontiff, the merits of the saints, and miracles. Overall, the list of what the revisers eliminated from the orations reads like a syllabus of Catholic doctrines and practices rejected by modernists, Protestants, and rationalists.
Since, as the saying goes, the law of praying is the law of believing, the collective effect of the changes in the orations in the new missal is to destroy Catholic doctrine by removing certain parts of it from the liturgy, and thus from the consciousness of the clergy and the faithful. But am I merely engaging in nothing more than what Father O.J. called an open polemic against the Pauline reform, as if it were nothing more than the product of human scheming? Judge for yourself by reading New Values and New Perspectives, Chapter 9 of Work of Human Hands, a Theological Critique of the Mass of Paul VI. Chapter 10, The Liturgy of the Word, Adroit Choices, Giant Voices. One mantra endlessly repeated after Vatican II was that everything about the Church now had to become more biblical, more scriptural. When it came to the Mass, Vatican II's Constitution on the Sacred Liturgy decreed that scripture readings had to be more varied, and that the treasures of the Bible are to be opened up more lavishly. So, when the Mass of Paul VI was created, the revisers introduced an entirely new selection and arrangement of scripture readings to replace the old lectionary. Before examining this change, we'll look first at the ritual setting for these readings, which is now called the Liturgy of the Word. As with the introductory rites, a new objective for the second section of the Mass required a change in its physical orientation.
In the old rite, the scripture readings were treated as a sacramental and were proclaimed facing the altar, liturgical east it was called, or in the case of the Gospel, perpendicular to it, called liturgical north, a direction, in other words, unrelated to where the congregation was located. Obviously, if you define the Mass as an assembly, you've got to reorient the scriptural part of the rite toward the assembly, too. So, the new rite is non-hierarchical, democratic, and centered on the laity. In the form that the new legislation presents as ideal, a string of lectors, commentators, cantors, and part-time deacons conduct the liturgy of the word. And as if this were not enough, the new rite overthrows 2 millennia of the Church's tradition by allowing a woman to function as a liturgical minister at Mass by proclaiming a scripture reading to a mixed congregation. It is now viewed as not only permissible, but also as an ideal to be implemented, even at midnight Masses in St. Peter's Basilica. The role of the priest is limited to reciting aloud 2 prayers, the introduction and the conclusion for the prayer of the faithful. But in case he feels neglected, he can exercise another legitimate option. Before the scripture readings are proclaimed, he may offer a few comments to introduce the readings. This would have lots of appeal for Father Chuck. It's the 3rd occasion so far where his gigantic voice can interrupt the rite to say in his own words what the words of the scripture readings will say 10 seconds later. Number 128 of the 2002 General Instruction makes all his folksy chatter quite legal. So no complaints, please, Father Retro.
The chants between the scripture readings and the old missal, the graduals, the alleluias, and the tracts, were unsuitable for the type of rite the revisers had in mind.
The full musical settings of the old texts are so elaborate and splendid that even in monasteries their performance was entrusted only to a select group of singers. Congregational participation in these chants was clearly impossible. To replace the gradual after the first reading, the revisers created the responsorial psalm. This consists of a number of psalm verses, recited or sung by a lector or cantor, and interspersed with an acclamation repeated several times by the congregation. The responsorial psalm is a typical concilium creation. There is no precedent for it in the traditional liturgy. Its existence in the early liturgy is suspect. The legislation allows endless options with it, and participation requires simpy and idiotic music.
As a church musician, I found the last point particularly annoying. The revisers insisted that the responsorial psalm have congregational participation. Now, it is virtually impossible to compose music which combines true artistic excellence and singability for a non-musician, particularly with texts as short as the refrains in the lectionary.
Liturgical composers were therefore forced to create musical settings that remain on the level of the lowest common denominator. The result is debased music that rarely rises above the artistic level of a jingle for a toothpaste commercial.
The responsorial psalm is a dog, one that should be put to sleep. In the 1940s and 1950s, the liturgical movement proposed introducing into the Mass a prayer of the faithful, or universal prayer after the Creed. Inevitably, Vatican II approved the idea. But what to do for the texts?
The oldest were a series of collects that had been used in Rome, and that the traditional missal employed for the Mass of the Pre-Sanctified on Good Friday. They included language that was less than ecumenical, prayers for converting heretics, pagans, and Jews, and for the triumph of the Catholic faith. So there was no question of a restoration here.
So Concilium decided instead to make the prayer of the faithful a litany, whose contents would be subject to change. Study Group 12 was given the task of drafting some model texts, which were then submitted to the Congregation of Rites. When the revised texts came back, the chairman of the study group, Father A.M. Rouget, wrote an indignant letter of protest to Bugnini, denouncing the outrageous liberties that the Congregation of Rites had taken with the prayers. The editor, he said, took the liberty of Christianizing, of spiritualizing, and of supernaturalizing all the petitions. Always in the direction of a devout and conventional religion, utterly foreign to the pastoral needs of today.
Bugnini brokered a compromise. The model texts for the prayer of the faithful were finally published, having been, one presumes, de-Christianized, de-spiritualized, and de-supernaturalized to Rouget's satisfaction. The parish priest, the liturgy director, or a liturgical publishing service, composes the texts for the prayers, another instance in the new Mass of liturgical deregulation. The deacon, lector, cantor, or another qualified layman or woman announces the petitions for the prayer of the faithful. In some celebrations, lay people line up at the pulpit, and each one reads a petition.
Sometimes they are dressed in costumes to add color and dignity to a special occasion.
Herr, manchmal ist unser Herz traurig und schwer. Verwandle unsere Traurigkeit in Freude.
Wir bitten dich, erhöre uns.
Herr, manchmal haben wir Angst in unserem Leben. Schenke uns Vertrauen in deine Kraft und Menschen, die uns immer wieder nahe sind.
Wir bitten dich, erhöre uns.
Didn't see a German shepherd bring down that bunny. While the traditional missal has a one-year cycle of readings, the new lectionary for the Mass of Paul VI has a three-year cycle.
Paul VI said that this new arrangement provided a fuller exposition of the words of divine revelation and would present to the faithful the most important part of sacred scripture. Chapter 10 of Work of Human Hands examines this new cycle of readings to find out whether it delivered as promised. Thousands of scripture passages have indeed been added to the lectionary, but a systematic examination of the work as a whole reveals that certain New Testament passages are now optional or missing altogether. The introductory material for the new lectionary hints at a hidden agenda. Difficult scripture passages, it tells us, are not employed on Sundays. Certain passages of little pastoral worth or involving truly difficult questions, it says, have been omitted. And in some readings, certain passages are designated as optional. What's really going on here? Well, when we compare the integral text of the New Testament with the selection and arrangement of readings in the new lectionary, we discover that the revisers sought to shield the average Sunday churchgoer from what we could call negative themes. Some examples: divine wrath, punishment in this life for sin, condemnations of impurity, narrow the gate to salvation, hell, condemnations of the spirit of the world, the errors of heretics, Jews, and pagans, supposedly outmoded cultural concepts on the role of women in church and the family. Such passages were dealt with by excluding them from Sundays, making parts of them optional, dropping individual verses, allowing a substitute reading, or omitting them entirely from the lectionary. One example occurs on Corpus Christi and Holy Thursday, where the epistle is St. Paul's account of the institution of the Eucharist in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. Here is the end of the passage in the traditional missal. Therefore, whosoever shall eat this bread or drink the chalice of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But let a man prove himself, and so let him eat of this bread and drink of that chalice. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily eateth and drinketh judgment to himself, not discerning the body of the Lord. The creators of the new Mass entirely deleted these words, and the passage appears nowhere at all in the new lectionary.
So, in terms of the purpose that Paul VI had announced for revising the lectionary, the actual result was a gigantic fraud. Under the guise of presenting more scripture, the Reformers, in fact, presented less of its actual message.
It is a trick Luther and other would-be liturgical Reformers tried countless times in the past. They use scripture, said the great Dom Prosper Guéranger, negatively by passing over in silence, through an adroit choice, texts which express doctrines opposed to the errors they want to prevail, and positively by bringing to light mutilated passages which show only one side of the truth while concealing the other from the eyes of the crowd.
It is a dangerous trap for simple souls, he said, and it is only long after that you realize you have been deceived and that the Word of God, that two-edged sword, has inflicted great wounds, for it has been wielded by the sons of perdition. To find out more about the new lectionary and the Liturgy of the Word, read Adroit Choices, Giant Voices, Chapter 10 of Work of Human Hands, a Theological Critique of the Mass of Paul VI.
Chapter 11, The Preparation of the Gifts, Teilhard's Offertory.
By this point in our examination of the Mass of Paul VI, we're starting to catch on to the Reformers' little tricks. One was bait and switch. You invent something new, but then claim you were just restoring an ancient Christian liturgical practice. We've seen how that works out. Another was relabeling. you change the name for some part of the Mass, and then you make an undesirable theological concept disappear. In this next section of the new Mass, the preparation of the gifts, the revisers used both tricks.
Ecumenical rebranding.
The second part of the old Mass is called the Mass of the Faithful. This was so because in ancient times only members of the church could be present during it. In some places, the deacon even chanted a ritual formula of expulsion.
If anyone is a heretic, let him leave. If anyone is a Jew, let him leave. If anyone is a pagan, let him leave. If anyone is an Arian, let him leave.
It's like the greeting in the new Mass, but only in reverse. Not very ecumenical, those early Christians, were they?
So Vatican II gave the Mass of the Faithful a more friendly label, the Liturgy of the Eucharist. The Offertory Rite.
The first part of the Mass of the Faithful in the traditional Mass is the Offertory Rite. Its prayers express three ideas.
The sacrifice is prepared, is directed to a particular purpose, and is begun.
Regarding the last point, beginning the sacrifice, the traditional rite uses sacrificial language that anticipates the actual consecration of the bread and wine.
So, the prayers refer to the host as the Immaculate Victim, and the wine as the chalice of salvation, even though neither has yet been consecrated. The language looks in expectation to the effects that will flow from offering the divine victim. Protestant objections.
This language drove Luther and other Protestants crazy, because among other things it meant that the Mass was a sacrifice of propitiation, offered to make satisfaction for sin.
Luther called the Catholic offertory an abomination, on account of which nearly everything sounds and reeks of oblation. He also objected to the prayers, said one Lutheran liturgist, because they anticipated the consecration and the miracle of the Mass, and invoked the divine blessing in view of the Eucharistic sacrifice to be offered. So in their own Reformed rites, the Protestants replaced the offertory with a simple direction to prepare the bread and wine. Why abolish the offertory?
The modernist wing of the 20th century liturgical movement likewise sought to do away with the traditional offertory prayers.
Josef Jungmann had proposed this in a secret meeting in Germany in 1948. Why? The adepts of the liturgical movement, like Luther, complained that the prayers anticipated the sacrifice.
20 years later, Concilium would repeat this same justification for abolishing the old prayers, claiming that they, quote, did not represent the genuine meaning of the offertory rites.
But when Concilium attempted to find prayers to replace the old ones, as Father Carlo Braga admitted, they could not find even one offertory prayer in all the various Western rites that did not refer to the concept of sacrificial oblation. As a result, he admitted, it was necessary to create new formulas from scratch.
Another triumph for restoring ancient tradition. But if the arguments from liturgical history were so flimsy, what could be the real reason for abolishing these venerable Catholic offertory prayers?
Concilium's Father Luca Brandolini provided an answer in a 1969 article. Quote, they also compromised ecumenical dialogue on the Eucharist. The Lay Offertory Procession. Before Vatican II, the lay offertory procession was one of the favorite proposals of the liturgical movement. By 1947, more advanced parishes in Europe
and America, as these photos show, had introduced the practice. But a whiff of unorthodoxy surrounded it. In Mediator Dei, Pius XII briefly noted that offertory processions had been introduced in many places, but he immediately went on for five paragraphs denouncing a, quote, dangerous error, unquote, about the way the faithful can be said to offer the Mass. The implication here was that many advocates of the lay offertory procession were promoting just this dangerous error. After Vatican II, the lay offertory procession was introduced everywhere as another restoration of an ancient practice. But the historical evidence for it was sparse. Concilium's internal working documents even acknowledged this, adding somewhat pathetically that the practice, quote, nevertheless should not be held in contempt. Not exactly a ringing endorsement. But the new ceremony is a silly bit of play-acting in any case. In ancient times, when a layman publicly presented the bread and wine used at Mass, he had provided these things himself. At the new Mass, however, the usual method is to have the church's sacristan place hosts and wine on a table in the back of the church. A group of laymen, who have never laid eyes on the hosts and wine before walking into the church that morning, then present their gifts to the celebrant during the procession. The procedure, Concilium's Father Rouget ruefully admitted, in reality consists only in making hosts pass from one receptacle to another. Another production from the men who claim to restore authentic liturgy according to the principle of truth. More deregulation. This procession is accompanied by a presentation song, which replaced the old offertory chant. Here we find yet another example of liturgical deregulation in the new rite. Practically speaking, the choice of text and music for the presentation song is left up to the parish liturgy planners. The priest's invitation from the old Mass, Orate Fratres, pray, brethren, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Father Almighty, was likewise deregulated. In the Mass of Paul VI, it is one of the introductions or admonitions that, according to the new legislation, the priest is free to adapt to the actual situation of the community. So while conservative young Father Retro, who likes to say the black and do the red, uses the old formula verbatim at one Mass, at the next Mass, his boss, warm and welcoming Father Chuck, is free to adapt the text spontaneously, any way he sees fit. Especially since Father Chuck's new boss, it turns out, likes to do the same. Bread of Life, Spiritual Drink. The traditional offertory prayers express a whole world of dogmatic truth about the Mass. The priest, as Christ's representative, offers the host, by anticipation the victim substantially present, to the Father. The sacrifice is offered for the priest's own sins and for all the faithful living and dead, that they obtain eternal salvation in heaven. The identification of the first prayer with Catholic doctrine is so complete, in fact, that the Lutheran liturgist Luther Reed called it, quote, a perfect exposition of Roman Catholic doctrine on the sacrifice of the Mass. So, the very idea of offertory disappeared and was replaced with the preparation of gifts. Initially, the creators of the new Mass wanted to have no prayers at all for this part of the rite. The priest would receive the bread and wine from the people and arrange them on the altar without saying anything. They feared, however, that some priests might do this a little too quickly. So some new prayers were created to act as sort of a ritual speed bump. Thus the prayer for presenting the bread reads, Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the bread we offer you, fruit of the earth and work of human hands. It will become for us the bread of life. All the old sacrificial language, of course, is gone. What do we get in these new prayers? First, the base text for the prayer is not Catholic, but Jewish. It's a table blessing recited at the Seder meal that Jews eat on Passover. Blessed are you, O eternal our God, King of the universe, creator of the fruits of the earth. Blessed are you, O eternal our God, King of the universe, creator of the fruit of the vine. Second, the prayers contain indeterminate expressions about what the bread and wine will become. This was one of the criticisms that the Ottaviani intervention leveled against the new Mass in 1969. Concilium's original drafts for the preparation prayers spoke about the bread and wine becoming the body and blood of Christ. This language was struck and replaced with the vague expressions bread of life and spiritual drink. No problems for ecumenism there. Third, the prayer refers to the bread and wine as the work of human hands. This expression was inserted into the text at the behest of Paul VI himself, who thought that the prayer should express the concept of man's work consecrated to the Lord. This idea, it turns out, originated in the writings of the Jesuit Pierre Teilhard de Chardin. Teilhard was a modernist, an evolutionist, and a pseudo-mystic. He had been silenced by the Holy Office in 1925 and forbidden to publish anything on religious matters. The source is Teilhard's 1918 essay, Mass on the World. To imply, as the new prayers do, that the work of human hands, like the bread and wine, is somehow consecrated at Mass, is another example of the modernist trick of substitution and devaluation. It destroys the reality of the consecration, it degrades the real presence, and it renders meaningless the Church's teaching on the matter required for confecting the sacrament. It is also, at least implicitly, heretical. Far from encountering a perfect exposition of Roman Catholic doctrine, therefore, the priest who recites this prayer every morning will find instead the smiling ghost of Teilhard de Chardin staring approvingly back at him. Summing up. Phony restorations of antiquity, abolishing venerable prayer texts, dumping Catholic dogmas as a sop to Protestant heretics, a fake play-acting procession, Jewish table prayers, vague language deliberately chosen to obscure transubstantiation, and the cherry on top, transposing onto the Catholic Mass an idea cribbed from the thoughts of Teilhard de Chardin, an evolutionist and pantheist silenced by the Holy Office. Thus the fate in the Mass of Paul VI of what even the enemies of the faith admitted was a perfect exposition of Roman Catholic doctrine on the sacrifice of the Mass. And we are supposed to believe that the new Mass, what the modernists call the ordinary form of the Roman Rite, contains the same faith as the old Rite? Come on. To find out more, read New Offerings, Chapter 11 of Work of Human Hands, a theological critique of the Mass of Paul VI. Chapter 12, Part 1, The Roman Canon, Liturgical Decadence. All the historic liturgies in both the East and the West place the words that our Lord used to institute the Eucharist, this is my body and this is my blood, in the context of a longer prayer, which is called by a variety of names. In the Old Mass, the prayer is called the Canon, and consists of one invariable text. In the New Mass, it's called the Eucharistic Prayer, and there are at least 17 different texts for it. This broadcast will deal primarily with the Old Canon. Our next installment will deal with the prayers that replaced it. The meaning of the term canon. The term canon is the Greek word for a norm,
or rule. It also has overtones of a fixed measure or a yardstick.
Pope Benedict XIV said that the Church used the term canon to signify that the prayer is, quote, the firm rule according to which the sacrifice of the New Testament must be celebrated. This implies something virtually unchangeable. Although we cannot give an exact date for its origin, the Roman canon in the traditional Mass is extremely ancient. Some authors say it originates in apostolic tradition. Others trace its core to the 2nd and 3rd centuries.
One of the things we've noticed is that the Reformers loved to relabel ideas connected with the sacred liturgy, usually with longer phrases. Ushers became ministers of hospitality. I was not just an organist, I was a minister of music. Because the Reformers sought to change or replace the Roman canon, the fixed rule, retaining the old label would have created a fundamental contradiction in terms.
The new term the revisers decided on was Eucharistic prayer, which they extended to include the preface and the Sanctus as well. The preface.
The preface, in both the old rite and the new, is a prayer of thanksgiving, which varies according to the feast or liturgical season. Typically, it contains three elements.
Homage to God the Father, enumeration of the reasons for thanksgiving, and an evocation of the angels. In the Church's early centuries, there is a tendency to provide a proper preface for every Mass formulary. The sacramentary attributed to Pope St. Gelasius, for instance, contained 54 prefaces, the Leonine Sacramentary, 267.
Sometimes the authors got a little too specific about what they were asking for. One ancient preface was a long and violent attack on monks. Alas, it was too early for one against the Jesuits. A lot of traditionalists these days might feel they could put a preface like that to really good use.
In the Roman Rite, the number was eventually reduced. The traditional missal contained only 15 prefaces. Adding a few more wouldn't have been a bad idea. But the creators of the new Mass came up with another dizzying array of options. The 1970 edition of the Missal contains 81 prefaces. Three more were added in 1975.
But what about their content?
In his apostolic constitution promulgating the new Missal, Paul VI said that the great number of prefaces are, quote, drawn from the early tradition of the Roman Church, or recently composed.
Once again, we have the customary appeal to antiquity. Oh, those ancient Christians. And as usual, we discover it is antiquity with a modern twist.
In their 600-page work documenting the sources for the new prefaces, Fathers Anthony Ward and Cuthbert Johnson state that the revisers adopted a conscious policy of forming new texts out of, quote, a mosaic of phrases from the liturgical tradition.
Why not just use those much vaunted ancient texts? The answer from Concilium's experts will sound depressingly familiar.
The principle followed for choosing texts, said Father Antoine Dumas, was pastoral needs. Thus, the texts selected had to be ones that could be adapted to the modern mentality. Therefore, he said, only a few texts were retained integrally. Otherwise, quote, the better texts, reproduced in their original form, would have been unbearable, if not defective.
So, in the new prefaces, we get the early tradition of the Roman Church, but only where early tradition is not unbearable or defective.
The movement to change the canon. The modernist wing of the liturgical movement had already targeted the Roman canon in the late 1940s. Jungmann proposed shortening the canon and revising the list of saints it contained.
Their motives for changing the canon
were the usual ones at work elsewhere in the Reform, ecumenism and modernism. The text of the canon contained ideas that the Protestant heretics objected to, so it presented an obstacle to ecumenism. For modernists, the Roman canon was objectionable because it was linked to the Tridentine theology of the Mass and didn't fit into their academic theories of how such a prayer should be structured. Bognini's assistant, Father Carlo Braga, said, quote, "All texts, even the most venerable, must be submitted to an examination of textual criticism and of psychological consideration, by which they would be able more fittingly to respond to the requirement of our times." The reviser's attitude is best summed up in the words of Bognini. The Roman canon, he said, represented a deplorable impoverishment resulting from centuries of liturgical decadence. Vatican II did not explicitly authorize a change in the canon. Instead, the general principles on liturgical reform that had been written into the Constitution on the Sacred Liturgy were used to justify the change. So in 1966, an influential book appeared, The Canon of the Mass and Liturgical Reform, to lay out all the arguments. Its author, the Benedictine liturgist Cipriano Vagagini, attacked the canon as an agglomeration of features with no apparent unity, lacking a logical connection of ideas, unsatisfactory, with its intercessory prayers full of disorder, deficiencies. After reading Vagagini, you wonder how the Church survived with such a prayer for over 1,500 years. His criticisms, as we will see, eventually led Paul VI to allow the introduction of alternative texts for the Roman canon. But before we examine these texts, we will first examine two other changes to the canon that were introduced in 1967.
A sacred stillness reigns no more. As you would expect, in the new Mass, the Eucharistic prayers are recited or chanted aloud. At the traditional Mass, the priest recites the Roman canon in what the rubrics call the secret voice. He pronounces the words in such a way that he can hear himself, but not be heard by others nearby.
Obviously, there's a shift of symbolism here. It is worth looking at this more closely because it pertains to the most important prayer in each of the two rites.
Symbolism and origins. Father Nicholas Geer gives the chief reasons for reciting the canon in silence. First, the consecration and sacrificial act are exclusively priestly functions. Second, silence harmonizes with the essence of the mystery. The material elements are changed without the senses perceiving it. Third, silence expresses awe. Fourth, it withdraws the sacred words from ordinary discourse. Fifth, it mystically represents Christ praying in silence during his agony. Despite extensive investigations by liturgical scholars, one cannot say for certain when or where the silent recitation of the canon originated. However, we do know from two texts, one anonymous and another from Almarius of Metz, that the silent recitation of the Roman canon was fully entrenched in the West by the 9th century at least. It was introduced most probably due to a spirit of awe in the presence of the sacred mystery. Protestant objections. In modern times, the move to alter the venerable practice of the silent canon originated with the 16th century Protestants. For them, the principal purpose of worship was to stir up faith by imparting the word to men. Though grim fellows like these were unlikely to hand out balloons to make the point, theirs was the worship as classroom approach. Men could hardly be instructed by a prayer recited silently.
Silent recitation also implies that a mere work can please God, and moreover, that the only person authorized to perform this work, a priest, enjoys a special spiritual status that sets him apart from the rest of godly Christians. These German Protestant babies would object. That's why they'd like you to know that their baptism already makes them priest, bishop, and pope. Wait till they hit their terrible twos. So Protestants rejected the silent recitation of the canon because it contradicted their fundamental teachings on worship, justification, and the nature of the priesthood, and caused you to end up in the group on the right. Trent's counterattack. In response to these attacks, the Council of Trent in its 22nd session, held in 1562, explained the practice as follows. And since the nature of men is such that it cannot be easily lifted up to the meditation on divine things without external aids, for this reason has Holy Mother Church instituted certain rites, namely, that some things in the Mass be pronounced in a low voice and others in a louder voice. At the end of its exposition, the Council, exercising its infallible authority, then pronounced an anathema on those who condemned the silent recitation of the canon. If anyone says that the rite of the Roman Church, whereby part of the canon and the words of consecration are said in a low voice, should be condemned, let him be anathema. Vatican II's Time Bomb Texts. The Council of Trent's pronouncement made the 20th century modernists in the liturgical movement squirm. Nothing could run more against their theories on corporate worship than a silent canon. And of course, they would have merely condemned, quote, the rite of the Roman Church whereby part of the canon and the words of consecration are said in a low voice, unquote. But the matter of an anathema stood in their way until Vatican II. The same time bomb passages in Vatican II's Constitution on the Sacred Liturgy that were employed against retaining the text of the Roman canon could also certainly be used against the rubric to recite it silently. How could a prayer possibly impart to the faithful rich instruction or make them conscious of what they are doing if they can't even hear it? So, the abolition of the silent canon, a tradition in the Roman Rite so ancient and venerable that no one can really tell us when, where, or how it began, fell victim to the modernist notion of worship as classroom and the primacy of the living assembly in May 1967, when priests were given permission to say the canon aloud. And with it disappeared the silence that betokens awe in the presence of such a tremendous mystery. For all, counterfeiting Christ's own words. Reciting the canon aloud, though, was nothing compared to the other change that followed it in 1968, tampering with the words of consecration themselves. Here, the Latin phrase that occurs in the consecration of the chalice, qui pro vobis et pro multis effundetur, which shall be shed for you and for many, was translated into most major Western languages as which shall be shed for you and for all men. But in Latin, for all is pro omnibus, not pro multis. It was an obvious mistranslation, so much so that even a high school sophomore in a minor seminary who had just 2 years of Latin could recognize the error. But then again, he would turn out to be a bit of a troublemaker. Omlor's landmark study. In the United States, the appearance of this officially sanctioned outrage galvanized the nascent traditionalist movement. Since the mistranslation for all men occurred in the essential sacramental form, which actually brings about the consecration, the validity of the Mass itself was at stake. The key figure in this controversy was the American Patrick Henry Omlor. Omlor had been the happy beneficiary of an excellent pre-Vatican II religious and classical education, and was the young father of a growing Catholic family. In March 1968, several months after the vernacular canon had appeared in English, Omlor published his book Questioning the Validity of the Masses Using the New All-English Canon. The foreword was written by Father Lawrence Bray, a priest of the Archdiocese of Milwaukee, who had been persecuted by his superiors for his refusal to use the phony translation. Omlor provided a concise recapitulation of what Catholic moral and dogmatic theology taught on the requisites for a valid sacramental form. He then argued that the new form in the All-English Canon overthrew the requirement to use our Lord's own words for the consecration, that it destroyed the true sense of the form by substituting all for many, and that it suppressed something essential. He also pointed to the rubric St. Pius V promulgated in the front of the Missal, which said, quote, "If one were to omit or to change anything in the form of the consecration of the body and blood, and in that very change of the words, the new wording would fail to mean the same thing, he would not consecrate the sacrament." Omlor concluded that due to the substantial change introduced into the meaning of the sacramental form, the consecration in masses that used the All-English canon was invalid, that is, it did not take place. Along the way, Omlor pointed out that the change contradicted both the Roman Catechism and St. Thomas, and that it was connected, moreover, to modern errors on ecumenism and on the nature of the Church. Questioning the Validity went through several printings and became a traditionalist classic. It appeared most recently in a collection of his writings called The Robber Church. Omlor thus became a trailblazer for the traditionalist movement in America, long before anyone would hear of Archbishop Lefebvre or the Ottaviani intervention. Many Catholics who were skeptical about the Vatican II changes came to reject them entirely once they read Omlor and became convinced that, thanks to this fraudulent translation, even the Blessed Sacrament itself had been taken away from them. The Defenders. Omlor repeatedly battled over this issue with conservative defenders of the Vatican II changes, including Monsignor John F. McCarthy, Father William G. Most, and even the renowned lay Catholic intellectual Dietrich von Hildebrand. The controversy even reached Rome. Bognini complained in his memoirs that he was repeatedly asked about it. So, Concilium commissioned a scholar from the Pontifical Biblical Institute, Father Max Zurwick, to defend the mistranslation. All the details need not concern us here. But the defense most commonly given for the mistranslation was that in Aramaic, the everyday language that our Lord spoke to his disciples, the word translated into Latin as pro multis really has the sense of for all. On the face of it, it's a goofy argument, since we're talking about translating the Mass of the Roman Rite, not the Mass of the Aramaic Rite. But this should come as no surprise, because the origin for this theory turned out to be a 1949 work by Joachim Jeremias, a modernist Protestant scripture scholar, who among other things dismissed our Lord's miracles as products of the great imagination of ancient man.
Great source for understanding the words of consecration in the Roman canon, eh? The true meaning of the miracle of the Mass explained by someone who didn't believe in the truth of miracles.
Omlor triumphans. The fraudulent translation for all would be used for nearly 45 years. In the 1990s, however, the emergence of a neoconservative movement among younger clergy, buttressed by the ascendancy of Joseph Ratzinger, eventually led to a wholesale revision of the post-Vatican II vernacular translations of the Missal of Paul VI. None of those involved, of course, promoted the idea that the mistranslation of Pro Multis compromised the validity of a Mass where it was used. But the tall tale told about Aramaic has finally been abandoned, and this modernist fraud, at least, implicitly acknowledged. So in the revised 2011 English translations of the Missal of Paul VI, the phrase Pro Multis has finally been rendered correctly, as for many. And after 40 years, Patrick Henry O'Moore, vindicated at last.
Summing up.
First, the Reformers relabeled the canon as the Eucharistic prayer. Second, they increased the number of prefaces, making their usual appeal to restoring ancient tradition, while at the same time omitting texts deemed deficient because they did not conform to the modernist worldview. Third, following a program they had settled on in the late 1940s, the modernists sought to overhaul or abolish the venerable Roman canon, which they regarded as an agglomeration, illogical, disordered, deficient, and in the words of Bugnini, deplorable impoverishment and the product of centuries of liturgical decadence. Fourth, motivated by the modernist theology of assembly and mass as classroom, not to mention a general hatred for whatever savors of the mystical, the Reformers abolished the ancient practice of the silent canon in favor of bombarding the faithful with the celebrant's giant amplified voice. Fifth, based on a theory originated by a Protestant and modernist who rejected the truth of Christ's miracles, the modernists falsified Christ's own words and the formula of consecration itself. And this is only the first half of the story. To find out more about the destruction of the Roman canon, read Deplorable Impoverishment, Chapter 12 of Work of Human Hands, A Theological Critique of the Mass of Paul VI.
Chapter 12, Part 2, The New Eucharistic Prayer. Fraudulent History, Hippie Theology.
In our last broadcast, we heard the experts who directed the liturgical reform after Vatican II dismiss the venerable Roman canon as liturgical decadence and plot its demise. This broadcast will examine what they created to replace it, the Eucharistic prayer. In place of the one invariable prayer, there are now at least 13 different texts approved for general use. We will also examine the changes introduced in the most important part of the Mass, the consecration.
The promulgation of the new Eucharistic prayers.
In 1968, a year before the new order of Mass appeared, Paul VI promulgated four Eucharistic prayers, or EPs. The first EP was a revised version of the old Roman canon. EPs 2, 3, and 4 were new texts.
But 1974 turned out to be the real boom year in the Eucharistic prayer market. As a wind-up to the 1975 Holy Year, Paul VI approved two new EPs for reconciliation, three for children, and another for the Swiss Synod that contained four variants. Thus, the current edition of the Missal of Paul VI contains 13 Eucharistic prayers. But that may change. Francis, unlike Benedict XVI, has a more freed-up outlook on stuffy liturgical traditions, so some liturgists believe he will be open to approving still more Eucharistic prayers. The structure of the new EPs.
The new Eucharistic prayers have a similar structure and form, like the product of some liturgical cookie cutter. This is because their authors adhered to the criteria laid down by modernist textual critics. These 20th century academics figured out what elements a real Eucharistic prayer should contain, unlike, say, that dodgy old Roman canon.
There are 9 elements in each prayer, but we will mention only one of them here, the epiclesis.
This is a technical term for a prayer that calls upon the Holy Ghost to descend upon the offerings and to sanctify them. The epiclesis was another hobby horse from the pre-Vatican II liturgical movement chorale. Why? Ecumenism, of course.
In the woolly sacramental theology of the Eastern schismatics, the words of consecration recited over the bread and wine do not suffice in themselves to transform the elements into the body and blood of Christ. One must call down the Holy Ghost with an epiclesis. Only then does the transformation occur. So, just as the revisers removed the offertory to accommodate heretics in the West, they inserted an epiclesis to accommodate the schismatics in the East. Nothing woolly there, about the reason, that is. The reduction of priestly gestures. The rubrics for the canon of the traditional Mass prescribe that the priest make a great number of ritual gestures during the prayer. These include profound bows, signs of the cross, raising and joining his hands, raising his eyes, extending his hands over the gifts, elevations of the sacred species, genuflections, striking his breast, and kissing the altar. In the new EPs, the gestures were reduced to a functional minimum. Why? Taken together, the multiple ritual actions in the traditional rite conveyed ideas that the new rite was designed to diminish or suppress entirely. The unique role of the priest in offering the sacrifice, the mystical otherworldliness of the sacred action taking place, man's lowliness before God's holiness, and the miracle of the real presence. The gestures, because they were directed to God, diminished the attention the presider was supposed to lavish on the celebrating assembly. They also immersed the priest's personality as an individual into the person of Christ, the very opposite of the new notion of priest as enthusiastic animator-presider. Finally, the old rite required that the priest keep his thumbs and forefingers joined after the consecration, out of profound reverence for the Blessed Sacrament, for each particle was precious. Paul VI abolished this powerful symbolic gesture during the very years in which modernist heretics were most openly attacking the dogma of transubstantiation. The New Eucharistic Prayers.
We can't analyze all 13 Eucharistic prayers in detail here. A few comments on each will have to suffice. For more information, we refer you to Chapter 12 of Work of Human Hands.
EP 1, The Roman Canon. Although EP 1 is subtitled Roman Canon, and that is how a priest like Father Retro invariably refers to it, that label is incorrect. Other texts may be substituted for it. So by definition, it is no longer a canon, no longer a fixed rule. Apart from this, there are other changes. One affected the lengthy lists of saints in the prayers Communicantes and Novus Quoque Peccatoribus. The revisers regarded the recitation of these names as objectionable on grounds of, quote, historical criticism, unquote, and moreover because they were, quote, burdensome. So, 21 names in the first prayer and 11 in the second prayer are bracketed as optional. Since these saints appeared in the canon precisely because they enjoyed great popularity in Rome, It makes no sense to continue to call EP1 the Roman canon, if it can now be recited without them.
Most importantly, the consecration was completely reworked, but more on that later.
EP2, Hippolytus.
This EP is the shortest, so if we're talking canons, it's surely the fastest gun in the West. Because of its alleged antiquity, moreover, it was supposed to have ecumenical appeal for Protestants.
Its source is the apostolic tradition, a liturgical text allegedly used in Rome, attributed to the 3rd century antipope Hippolytus, and reconstructed by Dom Bernard Bott, OSB. But Bott's text was not used integrally, and by now in this series you probably are able to guess why. Sure enough, according to liturgical scholar Father Enrico Mazza, it contained, quote, terms and expressions that our present-day theological outlook would cause us to misinterpret, unquote. Translation, those which would contradict modernist theology. Here are some examples of the omitted phrases. Christ as the angel of thy will. This was removed because it was mystical. God forbid. Our Lord dies, quote, in order to free from suffering those who had faith in you. Obviously, this is insufficiently universalist in its outlook, because it implies that only those who have faith will be freed from suffering. Our Lord undergoes his passion so that he could break the bonds of the devil, trod hell underfoot, and lead the just to light. Insufficient universalism again, not to mention concepts that do not reflect the mentality of modern man, that is, the devil and hell. Thanks to God, because he found us worthy to stand before him and to serve him as priests. The as priests had to be omitted because it undermined the theology of assembly.
Again, another bogus concilium restoration, and a restoration that actually came from a restaurant to boot.
For in the modernist Louis Bouilhet's memoirs, published in 2014, we learned that Bouilhet and Dom Bott rewrote the text of EP2 in one night while seated at the table of a Roman restaurant.
Talk about those called to the supper of the Lamb.
And as if this were not enough, in 2010, the world-renowned expert in ancient liturgical texts, Paul Bradshaw, endorsed the conclusion that the prayer in question had no connection with Rome or Hippolytus.
The ancient Roman statue used to link the prayer to Hippolytus, moreover, turned out not to be Hippolytus at all. Researchers discovered it was an ancient statue of a woman that 16th century restorers had cleverly altered and transformed into a statue of a bishop. The implications of this fact for the debate over women's ordination and ministry to the transgendered, we will leave to others.
EP3, The Roman Tradition. Much of this text is the work of Cipriano Vagagini, and it resembles his Project B, a text he proposed in his book Attacking the Roman Canon. EP3 is merely another text dreamed up in the mid-1960s. Three expressions in the text are noteworthy. First, the phrase, you gather a people to yourself so that a pure offering would be made to your name. This, the Ottaviani intervention observes, attributes to the congregation autonomous priestly powers, perfectly consonant with the modernist theology of assembly. Second, the phrase pilgrim church on earth. Far from being a notion drawn from Roman liturgical tradition, this expression is a pure Vatican IIism. It's the popular modernist code word for dogmatic and disciplinary evolution. Pilgrims of this sort are always on a journey and never arrive at a goal. Third, the phrase sacrificium vivum et verum, a holy and living sacrifice. This phrase Bugnini attributed to Theodore of Mopsuestia. Great tradition there. Theodore and his theological writings were condemned as impious by the Second Council of Constantinople in 553, and he is regarded as having been, practically speaking, a Nestorian heretic. EP 4, Salvation History.
This Eucharistic prayer has an unchangeable preface that must always be used, and the whole prayer is a didactic Bible history lesson.
The Reformers claimed that EP 4 is modeled on Eastern Rite Eucharistic prayers. But why not use one of those prayers verbatim? Well, all these were loaded with language that modernists regard as insufficiently sensitive to the mentality of modern man. So EP 4 is in fact mostly the work of Cipriano Vagagini. It is similar to Project C in his Dump the Roman Canon book, and thus just another 1960s creation. But EP 4 did seem to hearken back to at least one ancient source. Because its preface addressed God the Father with the phrase, "You alone are God, living and true," it was nicknamed the Arian Canon.
And since you've already made the Nestorian heretics happy with EP 3, why not cheer up the Arians with EP 4?
EPs 1 and 2 for Reconciliation.
We now turn to the first set of what I call the hippie EPs, because their language so thoroughly reflects the trite, "we are all one" ideological cliches of the 60s and 70s era. Here are some examples.
"You do not cease to challenge us to a more abundant life. United the human family to yourself. The power to serve all human beings. The human race is fragmented by dissension and discord. Enemies engage in conversations. Adversaries shake hands. Peoples seek encounters. Make your church to be, in the midst of humanity, a sign of unity and an instrument of your peace. Bring all human beings of whatever rank and station into the banquet of abiding unity."
So instead of saying amen at the end of one of these, you suspect that your response should really be a little more culturally appropriate.
EPs 1 to 4, for Various Needs.
The second batch of four hippie EPs is based on options contained in the Eucharistic prayer approved for the 1974 Swiss Synod. These are loaded with more cliches about pilgrim people, we're on a journey, and here you are, God, in the midst of us.
"You are always present to them in the journey of life. Your Son is present in our midst. Open our eyes to acknowledge the needs of our brothers. May your church appear as a living testimony of truth and liberty, peace and justice. When this earthly pilgrimage is completed, you now accompany your pilgrim church in the world. Examining the signs of the times.
It's getting so much stronger. It's a sign of the times.
These thoughts are so shallow, the image is so trite, and the language is so debased that it's nearly parody. We're all on that hippie VW bus for the pilgrimage of life, and God is our tour guide.
EPs 1 to 3 for Children. These are used at masses celebrated with pre-adolescent children and are governed by the Children's Directory. This document was Bugnini's pride and joy, his own personal creation, and it received the approval of Paul VI himself. The entire Children's Directory is based on an understanding of the Mass as a religious classroom and on worship as pedagogy. The second and third Eucharistic prayers for children feature a number of acclamations that interrupt the text, the idea being that children have a short attention span. The children's Eucharistic prayers are written in theological baby talk, and their tone is horizontal and cheery about the big, beautiful world.
The notion that you have to debase the Mass to engage children's attention and participation is idiotic.
In Catholic grade school before Vatican II, we sang the Latin High Mass every day. Every day, with the chants in this book. In the third or fourth grade, we learned how to follow Mass with our missals. We loved it. Even, and maybe especially, the future troublemakers in our group. And so today, our children at St. Gertrude the Great School sing High Mass every day. Listen to our 11:20 a.m. school Mass someday, and tell me that you have to debase the liturgy to engage children. Ecumenical intercessions. The Roman canon contains various intercessory prayers for the living and the dead members of the church militant and the church suffering. Ancient church discipline dictated that those who were not members of the church were excluded from her public prayers, apart from prayers offered for their conversion.
Even though this principle was indeed part of the pristine norms of the fathers that the creators of the post-Vatican II liturgy professed to restore, they ignored it entirely when composing the new Eucharistic prayers.
Thus, in Concilium's guidelines for catechesis on the new Eucharistic prayers, we find the following statement: the universalist and ecumenical viewpoints of Vatican II and of the so-called theology of the world have a restrained, biblical, but real echo in these Eucharistic prayers. Liturgical scholar Robert Cabier provides a number of examples. Bring them and all the departed into the light of your presence. All your children, wherever they may be. Those whose faith is known to you alone.
Nor is this treatment limited to heretics and schismatics, who at least lay claim to the title Christian. Even pagans get in on what Cabier calls the EP's universalist perspective.
During one of my Mass sampling forays in the Diocese of Rochester in the 1980s, I personally heard a colleague of Father Chuck take such ecumenism to its logical conclusion. In the Eucharistic prayer, the priest named not only the bishop of the Catholic Diocese of Rochester, but also the local Protestant Episcopal bishop. What seemed like parody then was merely 30 years ahead of its time. Changes in the consecration.
We now turn to the most important and sacred part of the canon, the consecration.
In the traditional Mass, the term consecration refers to the section of the Roman canon that contains the words spoken by our Lord at the Last Supper, which transform the bread and wine into his body and blood. The rubrics for the traditional Mass call these words the words of consecration. The rubrics for the traditional Missal further specify that these words are the form of the sacrament, that is, the short, essential formula in each sacramental rite that actually produces the sacrament's effect. As with the priestly gestures in the canon, these details, when taken together, point to the whole magnificent edifice of Catholic teaching on the Blessed Sacrament, the priesthood, and the holy sacrifice of the Mass.
Retaining the vestiges of this, of course, was out of the question. So the terminology applied to this part of the Mass, as well as the very texts themselves, had to be altered according to the tenets of ecumenism and modernism.
First, terminology. instead of referring to the consecration or the words of consecration, the creators of the new Mass signaled what they were up to in paragraph 55d of the 1969 General Instruction, where they spoke of the institution narrative and the words of the Lord. This is the language of classical Protestantism, as explained by the Lutheran liturgist Luther Reed. Quote, "The consecration is not effected mechanically and at a precise moment and place by the recitation of the dominical words, as the Romanists teach. We dare not limit the thought of consecration to the precise moment at the recitation of the verba. We rejected the category of space inherent in the doctrine of transubstantiation. We dare not retain the category of time inherent in the same false doctrine. As we do not limit the divine presence to wafer or wine, so we should not even seem to restrict divine power to a single moment."
This is also the modernist position. Thus, in his 1954 work Liturgical Piety, Louis Bouyer, who also helped compose the new Eucharistic prayers, characterized the emphasis on the consecration as a retrogression from true religion into magic, and as part of a tendency to disintegrate the Christian Eucharist. Second, the revisers modified the liturgical texts themselves to conform with these ideas. Thus, where the consecration section in the traditional missal consists of two introductory passages followed by the words of consecration for the bread and wine respectively, in the new Eucharistic prayers, the revisers altered the text of the rite itself to produce a historical narrative with two quotes, the words of the Lord. Third, the revisers reinforced the narrative mode for the new words of the Lord by removing the phrase Mysterium Fidei, the mystery of faith, from the words of consecration over the chalice.
This particular expression, commentaries on the traditional Mass tell us, proclaims belief in the miracle of the real presence brought about by the words of consecration.
The revisers excised it and relocated it to introduce one of the three newly created memorial acclamations, which, instead of proclaiming the real presence as the mystery of faith, proclaim it to be instead Christ's coming at the end of time, or the memorial, that vague word again, of his cross and resurrection. Is this a case of that rascally Bugnini pulling one over on Paul VI, who after all had even written an encyclical entitled Mysterium Fidei? Hardly. Paul VI himself ordered Concilium to compose these acclamations, because he feared that if the choice of texts were left to bishops' conferences, quote, unsuitable acclamations would be introduced, such as Dominus Meus et Deus Meus, my Lord and my God. So, the consecration becomes a narrative, the sacramental form becomes a words of the Lord quote, and the real mystery of faith is no longer transubstantiation, but a future or past event.
If you subscribe to the tenets of modernist sacramental theology, this will pose no problem. According to the principles of traditional Catholic sacramental theology, however, reciting the words of consecration as a narrative manifests a defect of intention that in turn renders the consecration invalid. But I'm not exactly the first person to point this out.
Already in 1969, the Ottaviani intervention noted some of the details mentioned above and raised just this possibility.
Thus, the crowning glory of the modernist despoliation of the hated Roman canon. Substantial changes in the form of the sacrament that alter the intrinsic sense of the words, change the ministerial intention, and render the consecration and the Mass of Paul VI invalid. No body, no blood, no Mass.
Summing up.
Given the opportunity to correct what they called the deplorable impoverishment and liturgical decadence of the Roman canon by introducing other Eucharistic prayers from the much-touted golden ages of liturgical antiquity. The revisers took from those sources only those concepts and phrases that could be reconciled with the mentality of modern man, that is, the modernist worldview. Thus, instead of Hippolytus, the rediscovered ideal of the Eucharistic prayer, or the substance of the Eastern canons, in the Mass of Paul VI we get stripped down, half-plagiarized texts that modernist scholars cobbled together in the 1960s. Or we get totally new creations, complete with shallow 1960s humanist God-in-our-midst theology. And for children, we even get theological baby talk. All this is seasoned with the modern and modernist desideratum of ecumenism towards heretics, schismatics, and pagans, a notion that would have filled early Christians with horror. So, Dom Prosper Guéranger's observation is once again right on the mark. Liturgical reformers who begin by saying they will restore Christian antiquity always end up by producing new formulas no older than the day before. To find out more about the new Eucharistic prayers, read Deplorable Impoverishment, Chapter 12 of Work of Human Hands, A Theological Critique of the Mass of Paul VI. Our next broadcast, The Communion Rite.
To order Work of Human Hands, visit www.sggresources.org.